Macmillan Audio presents Compulsion by Allison Brennan. Read for you by Eliza Foss. Prologue. 9 months ago. Sweat beaded on Adam Bachman's forehead. He told himself the lights up ahead were just emergency vehicles because of the accident. No one cared about him or this car. But it wasn't his car. He had another problem. The girl was starting to move in the trunk. Everything had gone wrong from the beginning, but he didn't see it right away because he was focused on her, the pretty blonde, the way she looked at him, and he knew she was worthy. When she looked over at him at the bar, she smiled a little smile as if they shared a secret. Maybe he'd imagined it. Maybe he'd made a mistake picking her. Why had the drug worn off so quickly? Except it wasn't quickly. He'd been stuck in this traffic jam for 30 minutes. Only one lane was open and the cars were backed up. It was summer. People wanted to get out of town. But it was Tuesday, not the weekend. And so the accident must be pretty bad for them to allow only a couple of cars through at a time. The girl kicked the trunk as the car rolled closer to the emergency vehicles. Then Adam noticed the two cop cars. They must be here for the accident. If it was just a terrible accident, why was his heart pounding? Be quiet, girl. Just be quiet. The drugs usually kept them out for 2 hours, enough time to drive to his secret spot, to revive them, to watch them die. Sometimes it took hours, preparation and practice to get everything just right. There was a fine line between life and death. Uncovering that exact moment, right before their very last breath, wasn't science. It was art. Every person was unique. It's what made his process so interesting, so provoking. If he made movies, he'd win awards for his precision and care. He'd made mistakes, but he'd cleaned up his mistakes. The last two had been perfect. First the boy, then the girl. And he thought this girl would be just as satisfying, more perfect. He rolled closer to the police cars. They waved cars through, barely glancing inside. Okay, good. Stop sweating. Why would they be looking inside at all? Did they suspect something? Habit because they were cops and all cops were suspicious by nature? There was no way these cops knew anything about the girl in the trunk. He'd only grabbed her 45 minutes ago. No one even knew she was missing. His process was perfect. No one had ever been reported missing until they were already dead. This girl had been very chatty at the bar. She lived in Baltimore. She'd come to the city alone to visit her boyfriend. She stayed with him one night, but nothing was the same between them. "People aren't who you think they are," she'd said. He had agreed. She'd read his mind. She stayed in a hotel on her daddy's credit card for a few days while she figured out what she wanted to do with her life. Enjoy the city, visit a couple of museums, eat good food. He couldn't lose, not after 5 perfect murders. The trunk was silent, but he still didn't relax. 3 cars remained in front of his. They each slowed to a roll, were waved through, and then disappeared onto the bridge. He rolled, slowed, and one of the cops waved him through. He pressed the gas pedal. A piercing scream came from the trunk. He froze. He wanted to press the gas to the floor, find a hole to drive through, keep going until he drove off the bridge, ending his life and the life of the girl in the trunk. Maybe they hadn't heard her. He glanced at the two cops. They were walking quickly toward him. Their guns were already in their hands.
Sir, keep your hands where we can see them.
Instead of fleeing, Adam put his hands on the steering wheel and forced himself not to cry. Chapter 1. Present Day.
Tenacious bitch.
Maxine Revere stood in the doorway of Ben's office while he finished his conversation with the New York City district attorney. Max took the DA's verbal attack as a compliment. After all, she had a love-hate relationship with him. In fact, she had a love-hate relationship with most of the people in her life.
Yes, she is.
Ben caught her eye and put his finger to his lips as he leaned over his speakerphone.
I'll give her the good news. Thank you, Richard.
He pressed the off button before the DA could change his mind, or Max could give him a piece of her mind. Ben's huge grin threatened to swallow him. He jumped out of his chair and squeezed her arm as he grabbed his blazer off the coat rack.
I don't know what you said to him, Max, but it worked.
It was as much you as me, she told her producer. She'd played hardball with Richard, and Ben played Mr. Nice Guy. Between them, they got exactly what she wanted. An interview with Adam Bachman, the 27-year-old bartender on trial for 5 murders.
You'll have 20 minutes, he said as they walked to the elevator.
The maximum exposure offices occupied half of the 18th floor of a 7th Avenue skyscraper south of Times Square.
Make them count.
She didn't respond to his comment, too energized about this interview to be irritated over Ben's habitual lecture. She'd been maneuvering for time with Bachman ever since she figured out that the missing persons case she'd been investigating since last summer followed the same pattern as Bachman's killing spree. Max was covering the trial for the station's news programming. She'd been NET's on-site reporter for several high-profile trials. NET wasn't CNN or Fox, but it was making a name for itself. It had exclusively been an internet news show until 3 years ago, 1 year before Max joined the team. Now, while 75% of its schedule related directly to up-to-the-minute news, it featured several original daily, weekly, and monthly programs, including Max's true crime show, Maximum Exposure, which Ben produced. She liked that NET was independent and run by a close-knit family with good business sense.
No cameras,
Ben said as he pounded the down button several times, as if the repeated motion would make the door open faster.
But you can record it.
And that makes you mad, Max said. Max didn't care half as much about the visual, not with this case. She'd been fighting for this interview for too long to quibble over the details. Months of talking with the DA, the defense lawyer, cops, the victims' families, everyone she could get access to, but not the killer himself. Until now. Exclusive. One-on-one. Pen, paper, and an audio recorder. An old-fashioned interview, because as the DA had said, she was a tenacious bitch.
Get him to agree to go on camera after the trial, Ben said.
He peered at his reflection in the shiny metal elevator doors and adjusted his tie. Such a yuppie, she thought.
A follow-up after he's convicted.
Max glanced at Ben as the doors opened and interrupted his preening. Innocent until proven guilty, she said, as they stepped inside the empty elevator. The doors swished closed behind them.
You don't for a minute believe that bastard didn't kill those people.
She'd seen some of the evidence, enough to believe the prosecution had a solid case. But she was a reporter first. She wanted the truth out, no matter what. And while her instincts told her New York's finest had caught the right guy, anything could happen. He's not going to admit his guilt to me the morning his trial begins, she said. I'll push for the follow-up, but these 20 minutes were hard fought.
If you wanted it, you could get it,
Ben mumbled. She laughed. I love that you have such confidence in me.
NET will be set up to do a live interview with you during the court's lunch break, Ben said. What happened the first morning of the Bachman trial, yada yada, then again when the court recesses for the evening. They'd like you to post comments on your Twitter feed.
No can do. I told you the judge's rules. Judge Tarkov had met with lawyers and reporters Friday afternoon about trial conduct. While court was in session, there would be no social media posts from inside the courtroom, or the reporter would be banned for the duration of the trial. Commentary would be allowed only during official court breaks. No electronics inside at all. If you need me, call David or Riley.
Where is Riley? Ben asked.
He sounded irritated, but it was his usual demeanor when he couldn't immediately order someone to do something. Though he hadn't liked Riley Butler when Max first hired her last month, the Columbia grad quickly earned her way into his good graces. Ben cared about two things, competence and speed. He expected the job to be done well and to be done fast. Riley had picked up on that immediately and ingratiated herself with Ben in less than a week. A new record. Max just wished her right-hand man, David, felt the same. I sent her on an errand. I'm picking her up on the way to the courthouse. He glanced at his watch.
Isn't that cutting it close?
It's important. She had Riley doing a bit of undercover work with Bachman's former friends and neighbors. She didn't want to share details with Ben because he didn't like that she'd been sending Riley out into the field. Ben felt an office assistant should be in the office assisting. Max countered that an office assistant should be assisting in whatever needed to be done. If said assistant could take care of basic footwork that gave Max more time with research and interviews, and more time to write. The elevator doors opened. They stepped out and headed toward the exit. Voices echoed in the cavernous lobby, so Ben lowered his voice.
Are you going to ask him about the partner?
Of course, she caught Ben's eye. Why?
I kind of told Richard that you weren't pursuing that line of inquiry, he said as he cleared his throat.
Why the hell would you say that? You know that's the primary reason I wanted this interview.
I thought you wanted to find out if he killed the Palazzolos.
I know Bachman was involved. I want proof. And you damn well know that I've been working on this killing pair theory for months.
When you're not flying down to Miami to annoy your ex or flying off to California to screw your lover.
Screw you, she said. Sometimes Ben acted like the little brother she never had. You had no right telling Rich I dropped that theory. I'll ask Bachman whatever I damn well please. Ex-Army Ranger, personal assistant, and sometime bodyguard David Kane approached them. She had never wanted a bodyguard or a personal assistant, but after threats during a trial nearly 2 years ago, Ben had insisted. Now David was not only indispensable, he was her closest friend and the only person she trusted explicitly. He'd earned it, largely because he hadn't quit on her, though she'd given him ample opportunity, and he seemed to be the diffuser of wars waged between Ben and Max. Truth was, she wasn't the easiest person to work for.
David, I emailed you a revised schedule, Ben said,
ignoring Max's glare. She was not dropping it, and he knew it. So why would he tell the DA, her friends, sort of, that she would? David nodded once.
We have to go, Max. I'm parked illegally.
Ben will pay for the ticket, Max said. She patted him on the cheek, still angry that he was playing games with her interview. Won't you, Benji?
He reddened. Just watch yourself.
I didn't make that ridiculous promise.
The DA is an asset to NET. Don't blow it.
Let me handle Richard Milligan and never make a promise for me that you know damn well I won't keep.
Max, This is a great case for you. Meaning, don't blow it. Stop trying to piss me off. Your interview is going to be picked up everywhere. Just, well, do what you do best.
She arched an eyebrow.
Antagonize people?
Find the truth.
She relaxed.
She and Ben butted heads often, but she respected him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.